to hold the rain off for a little while.
Good.
Because it's not about rain, it's about time.
Yeah.
Right. All right? And I want to thank you all for coming. All right? Yesterday,
I'd like one.
Thank you, ma'am. These are 2-minute timers. reason I chose two-minute timers is nobody except for me, I'm so sorry, should speak for more than 2 minutes. And we can say in 2 minutes what we mean.
Everybody got one?
No. It's just time. Timers, and we will take them around and show them and use them to tell people that it's time to move.
Everybody got a timer?
Children! Wow, I like it. So we have a few little massive cheers. And we're here to say it's time.
Month.
Yeah.
If I could get an increase like the COLA is supposed to do for us,
I might be able to afford things I can't afford right now, which is some of my medical expenses.
Yeah.
I'm not taking some medicine I should be taking.
Yeah, me
with
too.
My problem.
Yeah.
Everybody in this group has to get involved. I work at IHHS Public Authority on a governing body, and I represent people who get assistance from them, and my colleague over here does too. We have a letter we have drafted for the governor.
Yeah.
We have already 150 letters signed.
Yeah.
If you will be kind enough to take your time before the end of going home to sign this letter.
It's time to sign.
It's time to sign.
But we don't have the money to pay for the stamps. I can't pay for all of them. So when you sign it, if you can donate 50 cents, we'll get them all in the mail tomorrow and line it up. So I hope you will get your time to sign that letter. And thank you for hearing from me.
That bill that was done by Thurman and
Cheryl Brown,
when it was coming up, and even before it was a bill, we went to Sacramento.
Yes, we did.
And
we did.
Spoke.
Multiple times.
We spoke.
Yes.
Oakland, San Francisco.
Yes.
We did that. And I will tell you something. Cheryl Brown cried that day.
Yeah.
She cried because she heard the story.
Yeah.
She and Assemblyman Thurman,
that's right.
The one from the other side there,
Tony,
stayed up all night and wrote the bill asking for exactly what we spoke for. They were first told, no, it shouldn't be legislation. We should put it in the budget. I want you to know they tried that way. And when it was in the budget, it was the first thing that was blue-penciled by the governor.
Of course.
So they went back to the legislation, and you heard what happened. But Cheryl Brown and Tony Thurman aren't going to back down.
Right.
We will be there to speak at all of the hearings.
Yeah.
And we will be there to hound the governor to sign it.
Yes.
And I want to thank all of you who were there that day.
Yeah.
Because you made a big difference.
Yay!
Now we're going to have Lizzie speak about her. She's going to speak about time to reduce prison spending and investing in our community. Where are you, Lizzie?
Good afternoon, everybody. All right. Well, yesterday, Jerry Brown demonstrated once again that he plans to continue pouring money into expanding and reinforcing plans to address the prison crisis, including what he referred to as durable population reduction. Last year, he said that we need to find more compassionate, more effective, less expensive ways to deal with crime. This budget exposed these declarations as empty promises, as the state is doing the same thing it has done for decades, relying on imprisonment to address problems caused by a fraying social safety net, unemployment, over-policing, and inadequate access to health care and quality education. Instead of durable population reduction, this budget projects an increase to the number of people incarcerated in the state prison and proposes growing and strengthening the capacity of the system itself. For years, community members and state legislators have been calling for the closure of Norco, a decrepit prison with deplorable living conditions, infested by vermin, with illegal water temperatures and unusable bathrooms. Rather, the CDCR said they would close this decaying prison by this June. And use that closure as a way to justify expanding two of our other prisons. This year, those expansions are opening up,
and yet they're not closing Norco prisons. They're actually going in the opposite direction, investing $6 million for upkeep to the prison, allowing it to continue imprisoning nearly 3,000 people in these private prisons. The contract with in-state prisons, where nearly 6,000 people are incarcerated, were set to expire at the end of this year. The budget proposes extending those contracts. This bolstered commitment to incarceration is not just at the level of our state prisons. Once again, the state plans to pour money into building and expanding county jails. Since 2008, the state has invested $2.2 billion to build new jails in 41 counties. This budget proposes another $250 million for jail expansion, bringing the total to nearly $2.5 billion the state has invested in growing and strengthening local imprisonment. Pitiful funding for alternatives to incarceration and community-based treatment programs. Despite all of Brown's rhetoric around innovation and addressing the crisis of our prison system, he's demonstrated that he's not interested in doing anything but maintaining the status quo.
Yeah.
While the budget is negotiated over the next few months, we must demand true investments in alternatives to incarceration and in programs that support and empower low-income communities.
That's right.
It is time for comprehensive sentencing reform that will help people return to their families.
Yes.
It is time to close prisons and end our contracts with private prisons in and out of
Right.
It is time to stop pouring money into jails, prisons, and policing and invest in the programs and services that will ensure opportunities for all Californians.
Yes.
For our governor to learn how to learn. And he hasn't. One of the other reasons that I have a problem with Jerry Brown is because I never know which Jerry Brown I'm talking to.
Dr. Jekyll or Mr. Hyde?
He does another. What can I say? Well, thank you very much. Now we have Colleen from St. Anthony.
All right.
She is going to talk about the need to fight homelessness. And where are you? Oh, right here, the
Kennedy's
behind me.
Sneaking up on you.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
I'm
homelessness.
Yes. Yes. So, we have been hearing some exciting things from the Senate around their plans related to homelessness. One thing that was missing is that we really want to see not just an investment in housing, which of course is crucial to ending homelessness. Homelessness ends with the home.
Right.
But there's another thing that we need to stop doing, to stop spending money on related to homelessness, and that's criminalizing homelessness.
Yeah!
We are wasting money on issuing tickets for sitting, sleeping, and lying down to people all across California who are homeless and have nowhere else to go.
Right.
It's not just a waste of time. It's a it's against civil rights. It's against human rights. And it's not an appropriate response to poverty.
That's right.
Criminalization is not an appropriate response to poverty. So we are excited to look forward not just to more housing for homeless people, but also to stopping the criminalization and targeting of people whose only crime is their poverty. These two things need to happen hand in hand. Stop the criminalization and expand housing in order for us to truly respond to homelessness in a way that is going to actually solve homelessness.
That's right.
So, what I have to say, it's time to stop criminalizing poverty. It's time to build more housing that homeless people can afford.
Thank you. Right.
Right.
Right. Right. Right. Right.
Right. Right. The thing about homelessness, as a teacher, I know that we are seeing more children who are homeless coming to our school. These children know, and their parents know, that the only way out of poverty is through education. The only way out of jail is through education. These children have no home to go to after school.
That's a shame.
And they have no food to eat before they come to our classes.
That's a shame.
So it is absolutely about time to care for those who are going to be caring for us.
Yes!
Yeah.
It's time!
Thank you, leaders! a program that has been cut and cut and cut. Sheila.
I'm trying. How do I get over there?
Hold on. We gotcha. Hold on just a second.
She's on her way. And you ain't seen nothing yet till you hear from her.
There we go.
All right, here we go.
I'm going to hold the mic. You're going to hold the mic. Like your kisses. Oh, she does.
The time has come today. The time has come to put an hourglass to start the healing.
Right.
So the first thing I need is I need everyone to say stop the cuts and start the healing.
Stop the cuts and start the healing. Stop the cuts and start the healing. Stop the cuts and start the healing.
All right. So I'm supposed to talk about IHHS, but I just want to say that the whole of the safety net is incredibly important. And for those of us who don't have the money that Mr. Brown seems to take so for granted, with his house on the edge of the Oakland Hills that can slide, if the next El Nino package, it's already raining, folks.
It's already.
It's raining, it's pouring, the governor is snoring, he went to bed with a coat on his head, and we don't get up in the morning.
That's right.
The IHHS workers aren't getting enough, and they're not getting a fair wage, and we aren't getting the hours that we need.
Right.
So, yes, it is a shame. And Governor Brown is supposed to be a Democrat, but you know we've been fighting this drought for years. And we say when it's brown, flush it down.
Oh, yeah.
Since 2011, the IHSS budget has doubled, but the caseload has raised about 12%. This is all estimated. And I don't trust my memory. I recommend that if you want factoids for policy wonks and backgrounds to stories, I'm speaking to the press now, go to CD CAN, that's Charlie Delta CAN, like I can do it. It stands for the California Disability,
Action Network?
I don't remember the acronym. Community Action Network. The guy that runs it is right out of Sacramento, so he's right where the action is. And I want to sing out to Oakland. I want to sing out to all the rallies that are in solidarity with us today.
That's right.
And I want to sing out to every single person who is under the poverty line and struggling to survive every day. They say no cola, I say I want my soda. I can't afford my groceries, they tell me that things haven't increased. Do tell that to PG&E, will you please?
Okay.
Do tell that when I have to pay my, where I have to figure out whether I pay my medication or get laundry done because they're about the same price when I do my copay. Do tell that to my grocers and my phone bill and my cable bill and my, which I need for internet so I can stay connected to this whole thing. Anyway, so yes, IHSS, we need it. Without it, there are people who don't get up in the morning. Without it, there are people who don't go to bed at night. Without it, there are parents who can't take care of their kids who have disabilities. And because of how things are, these parents can't work. I know I'm over 2 minutes, but
it's okay.
These parents can't work. And so they're taking care of their kids. They can't bring in other money, and yet IHSS has been changed so that they don't get paid to take care of their children, to do the nursing that and other care that is needed. And the community long-term services and supports aren't there. And it is well and truly known, and it can be found anywhere if you Google it. Google California long-term services and supports, and you'll get more than you ever bargained for. But
it's time.
It's time to change this. It's time to make it better because we need to get this up and running, and we need, and in our communities, we save the government money. If you put us in institutions,
not only are we cranky and bitchy, but we cost a lot more money. So we need these long-term services and supports. It's raining!
It's raining.
Not this minute, but it will be tonight, and it will be, and even with all this rain, we're still in a drought. So,
yeah. You can't really add anything, but I've got to add something to this, because IHHS is important for other things. And let me just tell you something. Seniors and people with disabilities are isolated if they don't have IHHS. They are isolated by themselves with no help. And that is a terrible sin.
Yes,
you know, the governor can walk out of his office and talk to everybody he wants to talk to. He doesn't understand what it's like to be alone. He doesn't understand what it's like to be hungry. He doesn't understand what it's like to need help. And he doesn't understand how to really communicate with the people who elected him.
Right.
Yeah, and I am a Bay Area organizer with California Immigrant Policy Center. I am here today amid the news of deportation raids targeting Central American refugees and administrative relief programs such as extended DACA and DAPA held up in court nationally. However, California continues to protect and advance immigrant rights. For example, in the past year, California has ensured access for driver's license access for all, regardless of immigration status. And I'm going to let Sandy and Akiko here talk about Hope for All after I am done. And now, starting with 2015 tax returns, and I know taxes are your favorite subject, California will offer its own earned income tax credit, also known as EITC. EITC is actually one of the most effective anti-poverty programs that boosts the earnings of low-income wage workers through a refundable tax credit. Combined with the federal EITC, it actually really, state EITC provides a valuable relief and opportunity for economic mobility for struggling working families. Unfortunately, the EITC has an exclusion for working undocumented taxpayers. Earned income tax credit should be available to all who are eligible, regardless of immigration status. It is time to remove the discriminatory exclusion of undocumented workers from accessing the earned income tax credit in California.
Yes.
Commitment to eliminating poverty in California does not stop at one's immigration status. The governor should end the discriminatory practice of excluding undocumented taxpayers from accessing EITC. With many Californians living paycheck to paycheck, our governor must do and can do more to support the well-being of all low-wage workers in California. And I'm going to hand over the mic to Sandy and Akiko to talk about Hope for All campaign. Hello, my name is Sandy and I'm part of California Immigrant Justice Alliance.
Hi everyone, my name is Akiko. I'm part of Aspire.
And you know, as we were talking about not isolating one another, unfortunately, health isn't something that's prioritized in California by Governor Brown, unfortunately, and many others. And that's just speaking to the general population, and the documented community is becomes even more isolated as undeserving to be taken care of. And when we think about diseases, right, illness and sickness does not discriminate and does not separate based on immigration status. And many folks that live here in California are in mixed families. So what does that mean when we have two or three folks in households that are uninsured, but the others are, right? So when we think about moving forward and the health that benefits us all, we need to stop creating these separations of what documented and undocumented people deserve or don't deserve to have, but start thinking about the type of health that we all want to make sure that we all have, right? Because it affects us all. And last year, we worked really hard to try to expand healthcare to undocumented folks.
Unfortunately, we weren't able to get that accomplished in 2015, but we did extend health coverage for more undocumented folks, more in particularly undocumented youth, which was a big victory, and we're looking into continuing to expand health coverage.
It's time for us.
It's time
for everyone to have the same type of health care.
That's right.
As Sandy said, health and disease does not discriminate. And what does that mean when one person cannot go to the hospital and get themselves treated just because of health insurance, because of their immigration status? What does that say for our country? Health is a human right. And right now, millions of people do not have the privilege to go to the hospital and get themselves treated. As a documented community, we have seen our parents, our siblings, our loved ones suffer from cancer, die of disease because of health care. And this year, we are lucky enough to have expanded health to undocumented youth who are under the age of 18. But what does that say for the mothers and fathers and uncles and aunts, for our older siblings, for our college-age students, when we are all trying to think whether or not to pay for the medication or pay for our rent? It is time for us to have human rights. Health is our human right. It is time for us to have our rights. It's time for us. It's time.
It's time.
When I say people, you say power. People,
power.
People,
power.
When I say people, you say power. People,
power.
People,
power.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's time for everyone to be healthy.
As you who know me know, I never can end it. I have a hell of a time ending it, and it goes on too long. So I finally think I have an ending if you'll help me with the beginning, okay? So you repeat after me. Everywhere I go.
Everywhere I go.
People want to know.
People want to know.
Who I am.
Thank you for coming.